It's great to be here on this special occasion, on this gorgeous, very gorgeous venue. My first time to be in Scotland, I've never been here. What an honor to join the Postcode Lottery family. I call them family because they have been our great supporters on the fight against female genital mutilation for long. And I want to speak to you about my journey and my own personal experience as a Maasai girl and the work I'm doing right now with Amref Health Africa to ensure that every girl can be the woman of a dream. When I was 8 years old, I knew that I did not want to be subjected to female genital mutilation or forced to marry early. I had seen girls undergoing the cut. I had seen pain. I had seen even when they are fainting and many died. Once a girl is cut, she's considered a woman in my community, and that means she's married off at that early age and she's allowed to give children. Because why it's done, it's a rite of passage from girlhood to womanhood. And this was not the future I wanted for myself. My aspiration to continue with my education so that I could be the woman I wanted to be. When I was 8 years old, my uncle and my family planned for our circumcision for me together and my sister. A big ceremony was planned very early in the morning because they always have to do it at 4 a.m. in the morning. They tell you have to shower with cold water that has slept outside. The cold water is supposed to act as anesthesia because remember, you're not allowed to cry. If you cry, you're called a coward or there is no man from that community who is going to marry you. And that is why I decided I don't think this is something I want. And we had already planned with my sister on how we are going to escape because we really wanted to continue with the education. After waking up, I told my sister, this is not something I want. She also told me, I don't think this is something I want nice. So we ran away at 4 a.m. in the morning and we had to hide in a tree. But later on, when my family found, we were both beaten and threatened because we had already brought shame in our family. And again, this shows weakness in their eyes. So we had to promise that next time we'll proceed with the cut. So another ceremony again was planned for me together with my sister. She thought maybe if she stayed behind, I might be spared because I was younger than her. And she was right. Because after that, she told me, nice, we ran away the other time, we were beaten. I'm 2 years older than you. Let me stay, let me undergo the cut so that they allow you to undergo the circumcision. So she was not lucky, she got circumcised. And later on at the age of 12, she got married and now she's a mother of three boys. My sister sacrificed herself for me and I will always be grateful for her courageous act. When I came back to my village after running away the second time, I had to talk to my grandfather, who is a Maasai elder in this community. And when I talk about cultural leaders or elders, these are very influential people who give guidance and make decisions on behalf of the community. And my grandfather was my guidance again, because after the loss of my parents, I had to go and live with them. Really, I would say, he has been one of the people who supported me with my journey. I told my grandfather that I did not want to undergo the cut. I wanted to continue with my education. And I told him this every day and many times. And finally, when he realized that I was not going to give up, he agreed. And he told my uncles and my family members to leave me so that I could continue with my own education. Some people in my community started to treat me differently. Families wouldn't even let me play with their own daughters because everyone saw me as a bad example. But again, as I say, that toughened me up because I knew change has to come from within these community members. I don't have to wait for someone else to come and make change in my own community. And when I was 17 years old, I was called by elders. And they told me they were looking for a girl who could read and write. And I was the only girl in that community. So I always say, I don't think I was the best example or the best person they could choose. But because I was the only girl who had education, they elected me. And that is why I was trained by Amref Health Africa, which is a health organization that is working with women and girls for lasting health change. And the elders let me undergo the training. When we had a 1 week training on topics like sexual and reproductive health and rights, early marriages, teenage pregnancies, and issues of female genital mutilation. This is where now I got the skills, knowledge, from the support I got from Amref, combined with my own passion and determination that made me hopeful. And that reminded me that there is future, there is a brighter future for our community members. You see, changing culture is probably one of the most difficult things to do. Because when you're talking about issues of community, issues of female genital mutilation, it's a deeply rooted culture that has been there for hundreds of years. It's about changing behavior, it's about changing mindset, it's about changing culture. And what you need is patience, because you can't change people in one day. You talk to them today because you are a woman, they reject you. They are like, as men, we cannot listen to you talking to us. But you can't give up. Because as I said earlier, I saw death in this community. I saw a lot of pain. And that is why I decided I will never give up until we make sure that there is no girl who is undergoing the cut. And after the training, slowly, I started to talk to girls, to warriors, to women, to political leaders, to both young and old people. And after 4 years of dialogue, raising awareness, but more listening to the needs, the elders in my village changed hundreds of years, culture, and abandoned the cutting. I convinced my community, including the men, that our girls should not undergo this horrible practice. That is a violation of human rights, and that takes their dreams away. And they asked me, but then how can our girls become women? Because this is our culture and we love it. We don't want to change anything. And to me, that was important. Because as we know, people who have been to Africa, the Maasai people are known to be the people who have held their culture. But this culture said, there is a culture that is very beautiful, that is not a violation of human rights. There is a culture that is beautiful. If you look at me right now, the bead I'm wearing in my head, the crown or my necklace, this is not harmful. This is a good culture that we want to embrace. And together with the support of Amref Health Africa, we started the alternative rites of passage, wanting to keep the beautiful parts of our culture, but replace the harmful cut with education. Because investment in education is very important when you are trying to address any form of gender-based violence. But then again, with that, there is an education for the girls that they have to attend a 4 days training course. They learn about their rights, their culture, the importance of education, and on the fourth day, their cultural celebration of womanhood that takes place, with the beautiful dancing, singing, the blessing from elders, but this time there is no pain, there is no death, there is no ending of anybody's dream. You see, before, when cultural leaders are blessing us, they used to bless us to go and give birth, even if you are 10 years old or 12. They tell you, go and give birth to make the family that you are married in proud, to go and give birth as many children as you can to go and take care of your husband. But this time in the alternative rites of passage, they bless you with books and pens to be teachers, to be professors, to be doctors, or anything that these girls are daring to become, because I believe once they have the support, once they are encouraged, once we tell them to believe in themselves, that is the only way they can be whom they want to be. Because again, as I always say, they are smart, bold, and beautiful. Why are we not giving them the opportunity to be the people that we want them to be? I am proud to say that with these alternative rites of passage, girls do not undergo female genital mutilation. And thank you to all these community members, both men and women, but cultural leaders also, because more than 17,000 girls in Kenya and Tanzania have been protected from the cut, and they have a chance to continue with their education. And by saying this, it means that their future looks bright. My story has not been an easy one. I have seen hurdles, but they led to huge achievements, of which I'm humbled and proud, because I was the first woman, as Anemika has said, to receive the black walking stick, which is only given to men who are leaders, not women. And that made me realize that change is happening, and the community members are now accepting that we don't have to be seen as women, or we don't have to be seen as girls. We also have to be seen as human beings first. And by that, and with the support we got from them, I think it has really helped us in the work that we are doing right now. And as the Maasai people, our Council of Elders is in Mount Kilimanjaro, sorry to say so, and we have our own hierarchy. There is a special seating there whereby women are never allowed to go there. It's only men who sit there, decide even for women how we are supposed to be, you know, decide for us and everything. But I'm happy because of the work that we are doing for many years. Again, they were able to allow me to go to that mountain and talk to cultural leaders and tell them, as girls or as women from the Maasai community, what we need and what we want and the support we want from them. So when I talk of the 17,000 girls, this is a collective efforts from different people who have supported us. 10 years later, and here I am today as a global activist. I have had the opportunity to speak on global stage and use my voice to campaign for change. From being a bad example in my community, I feel today I'm a good example showing girls in Africa that they too can become women of their dreams. And let me tell you one thing. This change is only possible because it comes from the community itself. Amref Health Africa's ambition is the same as my own, to end female genital mutilation in Africa, and we won't stop until every girl in Africa or beyond can again be the woman of her dreams. Thank you. Thank you. The players of the People's Postcode Lottery in the UK are helping us achieve our ambition to bring female genital mutilation to an end. Funding received from the People's Postcode Lottery, where I work in Kenya, under the Amref Center of Excellence to End FGM, the project is training a full of champions like myself who will help provoke change their communities and speak against female genital mutilation, not just in Kenya, but also in Tanzania, where we prepare strong partnership and again scaling up our work to Ethiopia, to Uganda, and to Senegal. Because as we said, it's a problem in many other countries. Players of People's Postcode Lottery are also supporting Amref's new campaign, Health in Her Hands, which aims to shine and light on the women like me working across Africa to better their health in their communities. I can tell you with full conviction, the time for change is now. Girls are standing up for their own rights. Communities are looking for change, and the solution is in our hands. So please stand with us as we say no more pain and no more FGM, because we must all stand together to empower our girls to know their rights and to continue with their education. They also need these opportunities, and they can only get these opportunities if we believe in them. They need also, again, as I keep on reminding you, that it's important for every girl to be the woman of her dreams. Thank you for hearing my own story, and together we should, we can, and we are creating a better world for a generation of girls to come. And as we say back home, Ashe Oleng, meaning thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, because the struggle continues, but we are not giving up. We are ready for the task, because it's our call to ensure that all girls can afford to put a beautiful smile and decide whom and when to marry, make better and informed decision, but Molly get a chance to be either a president, a doctor, or anything she's aspiring to be in future. Thank you so much.
Thank you.